Моя героическая презентация,
This is my heroic presentation. I want to apologize for it in advance. I'm Vasily Shevchenko, as it is written here on the first slide. I don't really understand what kind of the audience we have tonight, so I want to apologize for the ones who really on top of things in comics, for the obvious things, and I want to apologize for saying specific things, so you will be able to question myself, what did I mean? And the enemy images in American comic books, I divided the lecture in three big segments. They are uneven, the 40s, 50s, 60s, and onwards. And in 40s, we will consider the first, then we will go to in 50s. So I'm lying a lot, so you'll get used to it. And so I can lean on the table and the chair, I guess. Before we jump in the subject matter, I would like to describe the terminology of American comics and our current terms. And we need to understand what comics means. General things for the ones who are familiar faces to me. Perhaps it will be unexpected for the strangers. Comics. This is an individual form of art. It falls into a very interesting border between text and visual art. And first of all, painting and literature, and it has properties of both. And it exists in its own world and ruled by its own order and rules of the game. And so we traditionally single out comics as individual art. This art has different properties and qualities, and what is important for us is to focus on one of the main features, the simplicity to project it on ourselves. If someone can imagine a circle and two circles inside, and automatically we can perceive a face. This is how the comics works. This is caricature principle. We are very bold and arrogant creatures. We see any circle, we take two points, and we believe that this is us. Comics are very easy to perceive, and that's why, first of all, they belong to the mass phenomenon, mass art. And sometimes I will be using the word genre, but genre is not a rote word. This is individual type of art that from its very beginning, it used to be a mass scale art. Because it is easy to perceive, unlike the text. The comics can be perceived irrespective of the language it is written on. Simple, complicated, any comics does not require a text for initial perception and understanding. What is the enemy image? Let me explain this. And how the enemy image is different from the enemy. Enemy is something real we are fighting against, but the enemy image is the way we perceive it. And what is more important, once we speak about the enemy image in different societies, this is not about the enemy, this is about the society, because the enemy, using the psychotomes, the enemy is something different, the other. So there is a counterposing, and based on this, the enemy, we create our own image, Nazi, racist, etc., and we are good. We are all encompassing, we are believers, and the enemy is evil, and we are good. And the capitalist is the enemy, and we are the workers, we are a proletariat. And so this is more about ourselves rather than others. And it doesn't matter who the enemy stands for. We will be talking about us, the Americans. Because I was asked to describe American comic books, first of all. And I will not touch Europe and Japan. And this is another different wall and universe. And I can deliver individual lectures on Japanese and European comics. So we will touch upon American comics. And I will be talking a lot about superhero comics. This is not the only one. Comics, but this is the easiest, the most popular. If you want to be explained about literature, you will not say this is the novel 50 Shades of Grey, and you just guess that apart from popular things, there are other. The same applies to comics. Superhero, this is the super popular type of comics. And in the third part of the lecture, we will discuss the rest. Enough of the introduction, and I like to demonstrate my math skills in making presentations. So, the 40s. And we will begin with the 1938. What happened in 1938? Back then, in 1938, the signature landmark event occurred. This is it. On the left picture, this is the first issue of Action Comics magazine in June 1938. Superman comes into being. This is the date birth of contemporary American comics. Even here, we can see a powerful explanation: A, why this is so much on demand, and B, why it is here, because it seems there is no personification of the enemy, so, but it's self-explanatory. And what the kids saw in the pharmacies, back then the comics were sold through the pharmacies chains mostly. And American pharmacy, this is a mixture of the Russian supermarket with the pharmacy. You can buy all things possible there. And back then it was press selling point. So the kids in the beginning of June, they came to a pharmacy and saw something. Perhaps they came with their parents, and because we're focusing on the younger audience, and they saw very strange man that for some of the reason he is beating his car. And for us this is iconic. This is a landmark cover page, and which will appear in the Superman, in the, so everywhere we have references to it. Back then, this was a brand new thing. And what did they see there? To explain it, we need to go back. But 3 seconds on what was happening in the United States at this period. And back then, there was a Great Depression reaching the stagnation phase. Great Depression is due to multiple reasons, because of the government of the U.S. was not very sound, because of the assembly lines it was developing, the old types of assembly. They started to retreat in the past, and tens of thousands of people lost their jobs, and they lived behind the poverty line, and middle class people, they still earned something to live on. But what do we see here? It's a strange man that takes and breaks one of the symbols of the new reality, Great Depression reality, the machine manufacturing industrialism symbol, something that deprives people from their jobs. So the parents that the kids there came to buy comics, so they were deprived of the money, of the essentials. And 10 cents, it's not so much, it's not so less, so they ask the parents to buy. And parents agreed to buy, but it was a super popular kind of entertainment back then. And featuring these action comics example, I wanted to focus your attention on the two that we will be talking a lot. To make a comics popular, some of the comics were popular, some of them were not popular. To make it popular, they need to meet a certain request from the public society, from the civil community. This is a cultural phenomenon, and as any cultural phenomenon, it needs to resonate in you. And the way I described the mentality, the way of thinking of the kid and parents, I'm not sure that this was the case, but perhaps there are many witnesses to it. And witnesses to that, this man, the figure, for the parents, this figure was resonating. The strong man, it was something that resonates with them. John Henry, the worker, and at the railway, and he was supposed to replace the pile laying machine. He took a hammer and heroically moves this machine, it explodes, and John Henry dies of the heart attack. And this is a traditional image that has become very relevant during the Great Depression. So human victory over machines. So it is depicted on this cover page. Indeed, it was an incredibly popular phenomenon. And, of course, they tried to reproduce it. I want to take off my jacket. Need to apologize. And quite natural, everything starts to get copied because this is a gigantic market that emerged in June 1938 by February next year. If I'm not wrong, it was over a million printing runs. Everyone wants to take a part of it. And so gigantic issues, so more and more stories about superheroes are coming into being. None of them is so popular as Superman. And with comics, Captain Marvel appearance, and you can notice and how literal, how exactly they are similar. And so there was a lawsuit on a copyright, and Action Comics won the lawsuit over with comics and acquired all their copyrights in the end. But nothing was as popular as Superman. Nothing is even close. Superman was, he's coming from another planet, he is an alien, but this alien was something which is very close family to everyone. I don't understand whether you are aware of it. Lex Luthor is the enemy, rich industrialist, genius, inventor, and human, but for the children of the Great Depression man, the alien of the Great Depression was closer than a human. And the 70s and 80s, then the publisher got back to Lex Luthor, and they will rethink it, reconsider it. They will be focusing on the fact that Lex Luthor is a human being, and they will be talking a lot on humans and superhumans. But back then, we speak about the enemy image, none of them, apart from Lex Luthor, they didn't have any outstanding features. Unfortunately, the history brought universal and unique enemies into comics. These are the enemies. starting from August of 1938, World War One has begun, and the comics books become extremely popular. In the there was a new image in the air. This is the absolute evil. Never before and after in comics we will not have such understandable enemy as during that time. Yes, this enemy has a personal, he has a personality. This is Hitler. And America Captain in the first very issue hits in the face. Or in National Comics Publishing House, there is Uncle Sam character. This is a personification of the American spirit. And they are not Japanese. Both of these comic books, they were published before United States got engaged in the World War II. It happened in 1941, Pearl Harbor attack. So the image of enemy is different from real enemy. The Americans were needed to be proved who the enemy is. They were very well aware that this is Hitler who is our enemy. And that, so the axis of evil, all of them are antagonists. Even though the country was not engaged in the country, two symbols, Captain America and Uncle Sam, they were two popular characters. These are fictitious enemies. They look like Japanese, but you can recognize German features in them. So they were wildly popular. And so it's not about quality of these comics books. I don't quote the pages from the comics, but in brief, I can give you a storytelling from one comics. This is the collection of 3 to 4 stories, 8 to 9 pages. Each, the plot is simple. The evil man makes an evil action, and our hero counteracts and saves the innocent people, and the evil man gets over, and so then the good wins. So 8 pages, everything is very brief, so no long storytelling, and they were not able to create a bright enemy image. They had something ready-made out of the box. They don't have to explain why Hitler is bad. This is Hitler. This is our hero, and our hero hits Hitler in the face. And in any propaganda billboards, you can differentiate our good heroes. They are bright and nice and light, red, blue, and white, and the enemies are green and blackish, and they would love to print black. But technically, one color black printing was very expensive, and so they tried to use these colors, like gray, green colors. We are in a museum, so these aesthetics that Roy Lichtenstein was focusing on. So these are the aesthetic colors to depict. So Hitler and conditional Eastern characters, but back then the global community had another enemy. I really like it. This is 2-page comics, and Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster, they drawn it for the Look magazine in February 1940. Can you recognize what is happening? And the front row probably is the lucky one, Hitler. Where is Hitler? And Superman comes to the defense line, New Zikrit, and breaks their guns, and breaks the planes and missiles. They come to Hitler bunker and grabs Hitler, but it's not all. Then Moscow, Russia,
and
Stalin reviews his troops.
The man of steel figure plummets from the sky, plucking him from the pitch.
So he comes to Moscow parade, grabs Stalin, and brings Stalin to a League of Nations. Everything is beautiful in these comics and non-functioning. League of Nations. Back then it was clear that it failed to stop Hitler from his invasion, and they failed to stop Italy from Ethiopian invasion, and they failed to prevent the conflict of USSR and Finland, so they failed everywhere. And this is before US got engaged in the World War II, so Soviet Union and Stalin, they look like the enemy for them. And so it's kind of self-explanatory. No clarification is required. So. And no time to explain why Stalin is a bad guy and why Hitler is a bad guy. They were, by definition, bad. And for comics, it was a kind of painful subject because the author, Siegel and Shuster, most of the first American cartoonists, they were Jewish kids from Brooklyn, from relatively poor families that disembarked at a new business for them, new business area. Where they didn't have established talents and plenty of interesting work. Joe Simon and Jack Kirby created Captain America, and all these people, they had all the reasons not to love Hitler. And so far, and even until now, there is a dispute whether Superman has Jewish features. It's not the Aryan guy, and all the attempts to convert it in Aryan guy, and they're doomed to fail. So, and he's brunette, dark hair, and then there was an eternal dispute whether superhero has the Jewish features or not. So 1941, and the United States gets into war, and the superhero comics, there is they reach their climax, and so this is a gold age of comics from the printing runs perspective. Never after the printing runs were so huge. They are focused on the youngest audience, and they are not infected by the big propaganda. And for the young children, they're trying to show something not really frightening. And what do we have? Classic stories on our good heroes. They stop the coups, the plots, and they are engaged in the war at the Allies' side. And another propaganda storytelling. All these heroes, they kind of stand for the borrowing. For the loans, borrowing money for the war. All the countries, they're trying to collect money, and the American way was military loans, and when the kids are coming to their children, they will show their comics and ask them, Mom or Dad, did you already help the Superman to defeat the enemies, the Japanese enemies? So the image of enemy becomes brighter and brighter. Apart from Hirohito and Hitler, images. We started to get such interesting characters like a Red Skull, and this is the top of evilness, the German agent, the Nazi. Firstly, he acted under the cover of the United States, and he tried to catch the Captain America in Germany. This is a classic example of absolute evil. And in the magazine, each story has 7 to 8 pages, and so, in fact, we know some of the characters, the Red Skull, and we will see it more. All these characters, their unique features, they acquired them later. This is a classic example on how this propaganda reaches this caricature level. This is a classic example. This is National Comics, dated 1944. And the same idea from Kukriniksy posters. And Kukriniksy, they had their own way, because this is meant for adults, but in comics the target audience are the children. The same idea, Hitler and swastikas is done in a different way. This is funny, he has a goofy face, he is in an awkward posture, and Uncle Sam pushed him aside. And you cannot rationalize this situation. You just need to perceive it directly. You need to grab your imagination. You need to buy it and tell your mom and dad about these military loans. And a little bit on the evil men. The evil men, they are not very like outstanding. In my favorite Master comics, this is the least interesting comics. They invented archetypal evil man. This is a captain of nations. If you can think of the German military outfit, this is the most beautiful military things that was ever created. This Hugo Boss probably was a designer with the eagles, with the crosses, and green pants on top of green stockings with the swastikas. The only thing that speaks that he is an evil man, he is a facial expression, but the rest is not really terrifying. Red Skull that on the left is more interesting character. This is the only one that survived throughout all these years and still with us nowadays. The most by all. Captain Blitzkrieg, Madam, I don't know, the names were really strange. But then everything was focused on the young kids' audience, and these characters should not be really frightening. But there were other stories also meant for the children. We will go beyond the superheroes agenda. So again, the format is very easy to perceive. And it's not a top secret that Americans started to devise their manuals in the comics format. And unfortunately, this is one of the most shameful pages in the US comics history. This is the manual, which is called How to Spot a Jap, how to find the Asian person, how to identify the Asian person. It's a pity that you cannot read and see all the details, but I can mention that the young reader of this comics, and who is responsible for safety of the United States, And so maybe the spies, they know American slang, but most of the Japanese whistle once speaking the sound S. And if you want to distinguish Chinese from Japanese, ask him to say Smith, that's the fortress. And so,
or try Lollapalooza, maybe.
So by their pronunciation, you can identify. So this is the description how to distinguish Chinese from Japanese by the posture. And there is a admiration because in not all the pages are shown, but almost each and every small fragment shows that Japanese are very dangerous. So they have a dagger in their pants and a gun. Be very cautious because anything can happen, because he will do his best and fight till death with you. So there were such things and quite a lot of them.
And let me... So
perhaps we can leave it on the screen. And also they published the very simple stories about soldiers' day-to-day life. It was done for the front line, and they were not really interesting in terms of storytelling. And this lecture for all ages, and there were risks comics, and risks content comics. This is on a verge of erotics and pornography, but they tried to stay within erotics. Anyway, there was a girl. She was almost got undressed in each comics, and it was for free distributed among British soldiers fighting in the Northern Africa. And it is believed, there is a legend, I don't know whether it's a true legend or not, that each month so they brought the sacks of letters, and soldiers were wondering when it will get fully undressed, and all the soldiers wanted to know it, when it will happen, and the author of the comics, and once she was getting out of the shower, and she got fully undressed in front of the soldiers, and after this happened, they advanced 5 kilometers more than it was planned, so they were really inspired by this naked girl. And it's no wonder that such powerful background, they're having such powerful background, the Americans, they won the war, and who knows whether us, the Russians, won the war with American help or vice versa, it doesn't matter. But once the absolute enemy image disappeared, the comics, they lost the most important component, the enemy, and so once the enemy died, and the superhero comics, they took over. And so initially it was believed as World War II was finished, and by the end of the 40s, the printing runs were literally zeroed, and everybody thought it's time to forget about comics. But maybe some of you don't know, the first issue of Superman was sold at the price tag of $10 million, but it's not really the case because it is old. Yes, the price tag is millions. They were published by millions. No one considered them as a valuable thing. And in the comics, in the military wartime reprints, there was a very simple message. You read the comics and scrap it. And the tons of old... So we can imagine the price if it is stored and kept in houses. And out of 1 million... copies of Superman 1. Now we have only 100 in a good shape, and several thousands in bad shape, and the rest is either not found or destroyed because of the military needs. And the superhero comics, they shut down, and what remains? Romantic comics remain, and there may be unhappy love, love triangle, and horror comics also remain, and supernatural evil is a, and detectives and thrillers.
Сейчас мы узнаем, да, потому что мы тихонько перемещаемся в 50-е годы.
We are smoothly arriving to 1950s. And what happened in the 50s?
И помимо того, что...
Apart from...
Окей, я сейчас расскажу, что это.
I will tell you
это начало холодной войны.
What it is. This is beginning
холодной войны,
of the Cold War.
СССР, США,
so,
капиталистической
United States and the Soviet Union, communist and capitalist ideology, they were counterposed, the comics,
простой,
they pick it up.
Это,
and the most
обещал,
famous,
да,
we will be lying, I will be lying, we are starting with 1947, one of the first anti-communist comics is called Is This Tomorrow? America
and
communism. Like all anti-communist comics, it was sponsored by a Catholic organization. The church felt vulnerable before the communists and left ideology. That's why they sponsored and they provided lots of funding and financing to this in Is This Tomorrow and This Godless Communism comics. And
and
this is the apocalypse-like pictures, and 85,000 official members of Communist Party. They operate in the United States, and they are ready to fulfill the order and make a coup in the country. That's why each free comic that was distributed at schools had 10 commandments of the citizen,
and
these commandments, they were tolerant, know your government, know what your government is doing, monitor the global movements, be tolerant, be religious, and etc., etc. And the 10th commandment, which has become the most relevant, be American first, this motto, which will be taken by Reagan and the other, America first. So this is a very American thing. The comics is simple. You can see the fragments, the Trotsky, man that looks like Trotsky. He is a speaker and his helper. There's a drought in the United States, and initially they arranged the hunger revolts, and then they provoke the religious riots, and then they killed the president and vice president, and they took power, and this is concentration camps, and they are in America, collective farms, and the person that looks like Trotsky organizes elections with one party engaged. What is typical here? No matter what kind of idea, no matter what kind of propaganda, everything is very relevant to the time, because the evil communists, they are faulty in all American problems, like a race antagonism, race conflict that really shook United States at the time. And the guilty party is always the communists. And at the same time,
the famous
Committee on anti-American activity was not launched yet, but the comics were very much in pace with these processes, and this Cold War trend was reflected in these comics books. That's why Captain America, they ceased to be issued in 1946 after World War II because of decreased interest, so it's coming back again. And so they're fighting against the traitors and some of the creatures, probably embodied by the communists, the Elector, evil man. So this is like Shrek and Hammer and Sickle.
However, I think.
And it speaks a lot to the point, and to what extent it was very much on demand, because this Captain America in 1955, they ceased to be issued, because the kids, they didn't have any demand for anti-communist activities, and it was not interesting for the kids. And this subject, anti-communism, it kind of vanished, and even though back then, there was a period when it was popular. And so the red evil men, they populated these comics, Red Barbarian, and Red Dynamo, and more of the red evil men, and Red Skull, that also it was transformed from the Nazi to the anti-American communist spy. But it did not work well because everybody was interested in other matters, and like romantic comics, thrillers and detectives, and everything was going fine until this nice man came in the being. This is Dr. Frederick Vertam. He reads the Shock magazine. This is a detective magazine. Dr. Frederick Vertam, he was a very reputable man before this book. Even if he didn't publish this book, he was a forensic expert on Brown versus Board of Education. He was a forensic expert that stopped the segregation of schools. He had German roots and he was a renowned psychiatrist, but he worried a lot on morality and the morals and seduction of the innocent. This is his book. So the influence of comic books on today's youth and how do they impact the youth generation. And
as
the material that was published 50 years ago, this was a set of not scientifically based facts,
and
it arrived in the institution for the orphan kids in New York, and he started talk about comics with these orphan kids. And based on this conversation, Vertam decided that comics, they kind of spoil the youth. This is one of the pivotal figures in the contemporary comics history, because sometimes he is perceived as someone he wants to burn everything and pray and fast. And the Vertam, he perceived comics very normally. He fought against the content of these comics. He
said
this is violence, propaganda. They promote immorality. They teach people how to commit crimes.
And
I need to mention his criticism of superhero comics.
Batman
and homoerotic context. Can you see it in Batman? Homosexual, homoerotic context. So I don't want To be a liar, and I want to display the entire picture. Batman and Robin, they wake up in the same bed and they discuss what are the heroic deeds to do today. It happens like in everyday manner. And here they wake up. He didn't even point out that there is a homosexual text. He said the atmosphere, the spirit of homosexuality, they are naked and they just naked next to each other, and the comics were strange back then.
And
so Nazi is back in history, and there is no other ideal enemy in the face of communists. So the comics, they were converted into the humor comics. And the problem of heroes, this is the rainbow Batman, who is trying to choose the pink suit, pink outfit. He has different colors. Sometimes he becomes a child, he becomes too small. And can we find the homosexual features in him? Yes, it is there. Is it intentionally embedded by the authors? Probably not. And you know, but this homosexual movement was a part of society, and it was not reflected in the culture. Perhaps they were kind of intentionally searching for it, but there were more interesting examples. And one of the researchers said that if there is a It's difficult, really. It's really difficult to discover homosexuality in Batman, but in these comics, you can easily see that the woman is also promoting homosexuality. And this is a Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman was designed by fantastic man Charles Morton Marston. He has two achievements in life. Point one, Wonder Woman comics, and she has a lasso of truth, loop of truth. Once you captured, you need to say only the truth. And what is his second achievement? Polygraph. And this is a lie detector. He was a psychologist. And he was one of the key scientists in his conversation with the woman. And she said, once she's saying a lie, her blood pressure goes up. And based on this observation, he came to this polygraph idea. And in principle, he was not an ordinary guy. And speaking in terms of LGBT, he was lower, classic lower. And his wife, he was in polygamic relations with two women, his wife and another woman, and in his comics they are so much different from the rest. They are standing out. They are absolutely not like the women in trouble. And even though she's tied up, she remains to be happy. And the number of these tying up. And so you know, it again, this is another reference to sexual relations. And but it was done in a very sound and human-like manner. And
It
is difficult to read the comics of superheroes, but these women comics are pleasant to read, they were nowadays. Probably Martin identified, the author identified something really important, which is eternal. Most of the enemies here were not superheroes, but this is something different. Such beautiful things that you can find in his comics. Classical example, romantic comics.
Комикс про преступников,
this is the crime dedicated comics.
Назовем это crime story.
Let's call it a crime story.
Ни в другом и ни в третьем.
And none of these three.
Нас не зазывают какой-то тонкой драматической игрой, обещание красивых
capturing our attention by enigmas or complicated storytelling. So,
Corliss Archer,
this is devoted to a radio show character,
and
everything is very... The most immoral thing is depicted on the cover page, but it's a comics, this is the crime comics. With the EC logo, they were the main ones, but they have the followers. All of them, they did beautiful. In big letters, it was written a crime. They had crime doesn't pay the serious.
And,
but I didn't find a good cover page. In the very big letters, it is written crime. It does not pay. So it's like an agreement, small font. Yes, you buy a car, but alongside you sell your soul to the devil. And this is very tough, even by current standards. The publishing and selling such comics to Russia, for sure it won't be possible. And Mars attacked them. If we look at the code that was adopted back then, comic code, this is an agreement between the comic publishers stipulating that we oblige to follow ethic rules, and in exchange the distributors will take our comics for distribution. It looked very similar to self-censorship. Comics do not show evil in attractive form, do not show that divorce is good, that evil always needs to be punished, and this agreement really impacted the comics. And the black cat disappeared, a woman cat disappeared from the comics, and her essence was like after committing a crime, and Batman used to catch her, but so the Batman, as a man, released her because she was trying to flirt with him. And once this code was in place, and like Red Skull disappeared from comics, many other characters disappeared, and there is demonic face, and they started to paint it in such a way that this is a mask, and it was written specifically, this is just a mask. And in the old comics reprints, the Kirby said, and the comic code was invented just to adjust, to redo the old pages, and to comply them with the code. This is the self-censorship begins here. So self-censorship pursued good goals, but it turned out to be an absurd. And this is 2 years past since the comic code was adopted. So this is 1953 Weird Tales magazine, Judgment Day. What is the point here in this Judgment Day comics? And this is a spaceman comes to robot society. Orange robots, they tell him, and that we are wonderful, but purple robots are bad guys. And this is the manufacturing site of themselves. And the Russian spaceman decided to take a look at the purple robots to get, and he visited these purple robots. And they were exactly the same inside, just the cover paint is different. And orange robots, they do not allow them to rule the country, and consider them to be a second grade people. And so the spaceman said this is unacceptable because Earth is progressing and it becomes Afro-American. And this story was published in 1953. And when in 1956, after the comic code was adopted and the DC Comics decided to reprint it, the dealers said they will not do it because this is a scandalous subject. And DC Comics was an interesting man. He went to court, but unfortunately, this character cannot be Afro-American. They prohibited to reprint this comic, but it was reprinted. But EC Comics Publishing House unfortunately went bankrupt. And this self-censorship win when the enemy is not something from outside, but this is someone from inside. This is the lowest point of comics on the one hand, but at the same time, the modern superhero comics came into being because of that. Now we are arriving to 60s. The comic code prohibited all other types of comics. The people said, what do we need to do? And they went back to superhero comics. In 1956, after the comic code was published, the comic from Flesha came into being. Most of us, they like it in Russia. In several years, the famous Justice League got together, and we cannot tell the story directly. We cannot tell about the terrible monster. This monster needs to be defeated, and that's why the superhero became wildly popular again. And the comic code that was adopted at the point then, then the comics and superhero comics are two different things. So this, we lost this moment, and up to the 70s, in the 60s, what we had in the 60s, the superhero comics dominated the market. And so it was the major form of response to an external request, Fantastic Four. This is a classic example. It came into being in 1962. This is a response to the space race. So they went to space and they became super natural. And even unconsciously, it still responds to a certain relevant request. And what Fantastic Four stands for? Four characters. Each of them got specific supernatural abilities. One man became super strong and stamina was huge. And another one was just fighting with firebands and women, a woman who can disappear, and genius scientists, these four. And this is the role of the woman in U.S. Woman in U.S. history is shown in this cover page. The 50s, they tried to defeat communists in the 40s, the Nazi, but in the 60s, neither 60s nor further on, we will not have it anymore. What they needed, these self-censorship norms that they adopted, they forced them to speak in a very strange language about everything. And this strange language is not such a good fit. Like in 40s, we are good, you are bad. And so
and
X-Men, usually X-Men, act as the allegoric superheroes in the world. They are mutant, similar to humans, almost like humans, and they are pursued prosecuted because they are not like normal humans. And the authors thought of them as a metaphor of any minority that is persecuted. And so it appeared in 1963, but X-Men, they did not fit in the subject. Yes, they were talking about racism, mutants, and mutants are not very adorable because they are almost like us, but they are different. That the comics on the cover page was saying that we are different from us. One of them is made of eyes, and another is wearing the horn helmet. And so once they say that X-Men or LGBT anti-Russian propaganda failed because in the 60s, for them, it was not a mainstream situation in place. I forgot to change the date, and this is the series that survived 60 issues and was seized in 10 years. It lasted for 10 years, and the new team and one of Native Americans was on a team, one Russian, a German, a Canadian, and in the 70s, when all these issues, they started to be less painful, only then they took their right place. The self-censorship and comic code killed almost everything. And this is an attempt to make a Vietnamese war comics. It was issued in 1968. Most of the comics dedicated to Vietnamese war. They were published in the 80s. I found several issues of these comics, and it is very, very boring. That they had bad guys, but they are somewhere far away on the horizon, and mostly these are U.S. soldiers saving starving Vietnamese people, but no evil characters are there in the issue, so it's very boring. And these comics will try to speak about U.S. conflicts. Vietnam was the major one, the Marvel. It's not Marvel. Before the world, Ike Perlmutter was the owner of Disney, and there is only one photograph, and he was a resident of one intelligence services. He was a remarkable guy, and he was one of the Trump non-official advisors. Marvel
took in the
he wanted to support the troops. This is was his mission. He wanted to support American troops at all means possible. So there was a pseudo-documentary comics based on real-life events, on life, on heroic deeds by American soldiers. And in normal comics, and the most interesting comics, when one of the friends of the Spider-Man friends, Flash Thompson, he was a hooligan at school in the 70s. At a certain point of time, he was reconsidered, redefined in comics, and he was converted into someone. He kind of became a volunteer in Iraq and lost two of his legs saving his troops. And the comics, they stopped to be proactive. Instead of being a tool of propaganda, they are just reactive. They respond to how the war influences life of people inside. And there were attempts to create this enemy image. And now it is devoted to one thing. This was a result of Frank Miller activity. It's one of the most famous comics. And the city of sins, it's one of the most outstanding characters of the comic world. This is a very respectful old guy, but he's not so healthy as he wants to be. And he's sitting at the entrance of the door, and he's sprinkling his saliva, and he's screaming, oh, why did you come here? And this 300 comics, this is a classical story on and like nice-looking men, tanned men, defending democracy. They stop the beast like looking orcs that symbolize the Persian soldiers, and some of them they're losing the human features. And in 1998 there was a history, there is a Holy Terror comics. It all began in 2011. Frank Miller come to BC and let's Batman fight Al-Qaeda. This is what he said. And they got strained a little bit because Batman never kills the enemies. And before the beginning of the comics, and he told them that Batman needs to kill enemies. And Frank Miller published in another publishing house. And this is not a Batman. Everybody understand everything, but this is not a Batman. So it almost unreadable because, unfortunately, it says that there was a gray mass of people living in the East, but most of them are bearded terrorists. And this is one of the attempts to create the bright image of enemy that is very relevant to reality. So they are trying to reactualize the news and bring the news to comics. So this attempt failed. We have more unexpected concepts, and sometimes the authors come up with the idea, but life brings more. The cover page, this is the Punisher comics. It came into being in the 80s. This is the first generation of anti-heroes. This is Vietnamese war veteran, and so he was a cop, and all his family died, and he bucked to senses, and he's a Spider-Man, but he kills everyone. He doesn't have supernatural abilities, but he distinguishes good from bad. Good ones are the ones who do not commit any crime, and there is no complicated motivation for him. If you violate the law, the Punisher kills you. This is his only punishment. And at a certain point of time, the American inspectors, they started to discover on the outfits these symbols of Punisher on the military outfits, because American military troops in Iraq, they resonated to these comics. And in Iraq, it's difficult to distinguish good from bad, and why this man brings water to you and another man wants to kill you. And at searching for this, just the borderline between the good and bad, and this Punisher has become very relevant. In Russian American Sniper, this is the Chris Kyle, this is the starring in this sniper, Kevin Lux. And the three snipers,
so they
killed 400. So these three guy team, they killed 400 men, and they called themselves Punishers. And they watched this Punisher comics. And in the comics itself, it is not a point of focus in the comics. Because years. Back then, this teenage story, so it still remains to be a teenager kind of thing. And even trying to find an image of the powerful enemy, the most impressive events of 2000, this is a civil war in Marvel, and this was the base for Captain America. This was the period when they didn't have actual enemy. And either Iron Man or Captain America. So comics appeared in the United States at the moment that the Patriot Act was adopted. This is tightening the screws after 2011. And once they failed to find the real enemy, so they tried to find these internal strains. And let us conclude on the bright note. There is an interesting comic. This is Holocaust classical comics. This is about the Jewish history and specific Jewish family in the 30s and beginning 40s. This another one on Palestinian conflict through the eyes of American reporter. So they explore the conflict as such and the more sophisticated than in any other superhero comics. And I would like to stop here. If you have questions, I can entertain your questions right now. We have 15 minutes. So, I want to apologize for being very fast. In which year this censorship act was abandoned? And so I will try to be brief. This was not the censorship act, and it was self-introduced censorship. And the comics that did not undergo this censorship process, they were not able to arrive in a distribution network. This was not coming from the government. This was self-censorship. And from the 60s, it has become clear that this is a bullshit because they were not able to talk about the drug abuse, even a negative sense. And in the beginning of the 70s, one of the characters in the Spider-Man started to abuse heroin, to take heroin, and these comics could not undergo censorship. And the editor-in-chief said, we will publish it without this tag that this is censorship is done. And, you know, and the distributors still accepted. And from then, even though some of the comics failed to undergo this self-censorship procedure, the distributors still accepted it. So, good evening. And we need to summarize. Now, in comics, so the image of enemy is blurred. Starting from the 60s, the attempt to find one colorful enemy failed fully. Many characters that are there, they were invented in the 40s and then redefined, like a Red Skull. But the most flamboyant characters and events were dedicated to the heroes, not the evil men. I would like to apologize for this kind of mixed and a bit confused conclusion. And back then, in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, there was the enemy image. And after the 60s, I tried to to capture the image. Once I was going through the later comics, I saw the 60s. These are the years when the image of enemy got dissolved, partially due to self-censorship and due to the complicated background of the superhero characters. Partially, the image got dissolved and disappeared because of the diversification of society. Why it worked during World War II? Because we had one single evil. Because in the 50s, there was US and the USSR. Conflict, and the world is becoming increasingly complicated, and it becomes more and more challenging to find one single enemy. And we tend to be more liberal nowadays. And so, and now current characters, they are focused more on themselves. So the enemy is yourself, double. So yourself is your enemy. The most interesting enemy is yourself. This is how it goes nowadays.
Нет. А микрофон? Они сейчас стоят от $4
и выше. $4 each. This is the price tag, and each price markup is a micro scandal. Do you have your favorite enemy?
Что характерно, мой любимый злодей, my favorite как enemy. Так называется, он в какой-то момент стал добрым, поэтому не совсем подойдет.
Turned
это
out
магнет,
to
злодей
be
из
a good guy, Magnet from X-Men series.
Его ближайшего приводили
and
Гитлера,
he was brought to Hitler.
Гранта Моррисона, New X-Men.
If you
это
read Grant Morrison, New X-Men, and this was the most recent attempt to describe the absolute evil in comics. But as most of the evil characters in comics, at a certain point of time, the
authors
of the storytelling, Magneto, he was a mutant, he was the ruler of the magnetism, he used to be good, then he was converted to evil, now he's good again. So this is one of the X-Men characters. And the major enemy are the heroes, and half of the evil characters become good ones, become heroes. So my question is very much linked to the previous one, Body Parts, the Winter Soldier. And I don't know how to interpret it, but he, in the beginning he's good, then the USSR, Cold War, and United States, everything is left in behind, but he serves for KGB. B, and it is not clear for whom he is working for, either US or USSR. So this is a double conversion. In the beginning he is good, then bad, then good again. You know, there was a classical statement in comics, everybody resurrect apart from Daddy Ben.
Gwen Stacy
and Bucky Barnes.
But
all of them were brought back one way or another. There's a good point here. When the Marvel was brought back to comics along with the Fantastic Four,
Баки, который боялся, и Капитан Америка,
и Баки, не существовало. They were non-existent back then. Then,
о том, что это были какие-то безумные их подражатели. They
said they were just copies.
Crazy. And
60s, in what way they're different from the 50s, KGB sent a super evil man to undermine American economy. In the 60s, this was not a KGB, they were just communist evil characters, KGB. I believe this is an ideal name. B. beast is a beast, and KGB, you know, it's a nice word. And the Baki was resurrected in 2007-2008. KGB was non-existent. The Soviet Union was not there anymore. And I believe it has become an absolute fiction. It's like John Le Carre novel. This is not so important that he works for the Soviet Union. This is in the past. Now, this is just a feature of time. We do not perceive it. The blasphemy to Russia, and Americans do not identify Bucket with the modern Russia. This is already in the past. It happened a long time ago, so Bucket can be interpreted in a rather obvious way. Someone who was misled, like after brainwashing, Captain America helper. And starting from 1956 to 2006, Bucky was not existent.